Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Imola for the final round of the FIA Motocross World Championship. Round 20 is finally here. 20. Yeah, but we are here, and I have brand new red lights at the top of my camera. It's fantastic.
That's what threw you, wasn't it?
That's what it was. Ooh. It was all twinkly and everything else, round 20. But here we are at IMX GP TV Studio Show in Imola, brand new venue for us at the moment. But there have been 9 Grand Prix here over the years, way, way back in the ages as well. More on that during the broadcast. But yeah, the final round is here. We're at Imola. Fantastic lineup today. We've got Max Nagelin, we've got Jeffrey Herlings coming in, Michele Rinaldi, Italy's first ever world champion. But Lisa,
We made it.
The final round is here.
It's been a really, really long season, hasn't it? But we made it. And well, they say time flies when you're having fun. And it's just gone like that, hasn't it? And
we're here.
Yeah.
I know. And what a great venue as well.
Brand new. Really positive comments about the track. It's really, really nice. Yeah. Mm. Nice hills.
Great hills.
You can't beat a good hill.
Anyway. Let's get on. Max is looking at us going, I have no idea what you guys are talking about. But Max Nagel, TM Factory Racing. Finally, we get to see you on the studio show. We planned it a little earlier on in the year, maybe Switzerland, but you've been out missing in action for, well, pretty much the last 6 rounds. I guess the championship, not kind of what you wanted with a brand new team, not what you expected either. What are your thoughts on the year?
Yeah, not at all. It started well. Okay, yeah. In the beginning, you always have some little issues. You try to improve. We improved the bike a lot. I had to learn the team, and we make good steps, you know, until Indonesia. The last race I did was in Semarang, was actually going really well. Mm. I was able to fight with the top 5 guys. So we really improve. And then the stupid injury happened on a German race and destroyed all my season.
Yeah, well, but tell us about the injury, but there were some complications with it as well afterwards. You know, that typical thing, you go, you get it fixed, it's not fixed, or whatever. So what was the injury?
Yeah, the injury was actually only a broken finger.
Yeah.
And you think like a broken finger is nothing bad. That's what I thought even in the beginning. And I was riding, not even a crash. I just hit a pole by riding, and then the finger broke, and I went straight away to a hospital. And then to my doctors, they say, you don't need surgery. We can fix it like this. Just keep it quiet for a few weeks and it will be fine.
Yeah.
That's what I did. And when I went back for the checkup after 3 weeks, they found out, oh, now everything is changed. Like the bone was completely in different position than it was before. And then they say, okay, now we have to make surgery. So I lost already 3 weeks for nothing. They make surgery. Surgery went well. I hope, and then after a few days I was getting sick and more sick, and then they found out the infection inside the finger. So then the healing process stopped, you know, it's not healing, and then you're suffering with the sickness you have, and I had to go back to hospital, wait another 4 weeks. Mm. And then when I went finally before Bulgaria, because I want to ride there, I went on the bike and didn't work. Even I went to Bulgaria GP, but couldn't do only the warm-up. So went home again, went again to hospital for another check. They say, okay, we need to remove the plate, everything out again, because the infection, everything is so bad. So they took out the plates and then had to cut the lines inside the finger because everything was damaged, actually. And then I had to rest again 2 weeks, and now I'm here in Imola. So
welcome to Imola.
Wow, frustrating, Max,
yeah,
for you.
Terrible.
But like you said, we are here. We're back in Italy. Last time we were here was in Ottobiano, and we've got a clip here. It was a good weekend for you, wasn't it? Because you got 2 top 10 finishes to finish 7th overall. Was that a big deal for you and for TM?
Yeah, of course. I like the track, and I knew that this is really the home GP of the team from TM. And I thought myself, I do all my best, but there I want to do that little extra, you know, sometimes you're able to do. And we had a great weekend. I had good starts, bike was working great, mm-hmm. team was doing a good job, and we had finally good results. Even the big boss of TM was there, so everybody was happy. And that was actually the moment where it changed into the good way, and we improve. And until that moment, yeah.
Yeah, I remember we did a pit lane interview with Marco, actually, and he said from Saturday to Sunday, you also made some changes on the bike, and that was also helping, you know, the result in the race on Sunday. So
yeah, always we improved, and it was going the good way.
Oh, Max.
Little Max.
You look young there. Well, since this race, you've hardly really had, well, you haven't had much bike time, have you? I mean, what can we expect from this weekend for you?
Nothing special. Actually, normally it makes no sense to race here in the Nations because I'm not fit. I was now 10 weeks off the bike. And also I could do only the cycling and the running, even no gym training, nothing, because I couldn't use the hand for 8 weeks. Mm. So the hand is really weak. I lost in this period 5 kilos because all the muscles are gone. And now since 2 weeks I'm back in the good training, but you can't build up in 2 weeks everything you lost in 10 weeks. But I said, anyway, for the team, for myself, I want to try my best in Imola and for sure for Team Germany at the Nations, and try to finish the season in a positive way before the winter.
Looking at some behind the scene shots here. Obviously we are in Italy. There will be a lot of TM people here. But it's not just about the racing anymore for you, is it? Your job has changed a little bit. Tell us more about that, because you have more of a development role within the team. Is that right?
Yeah, we will have a meeting this weekend because it's really close to the TM factory. So the boss is coming again here, and Marco is here, and we will have a chat, I think, maybe this evening or tomorrow.
Yeah.
And speak about next year and speak about the future, what's possible. But my goal is still racing. I'm still a racer. I'm not too old yet for quit. And I still have the energy, so I still want to continue.
Mm. Well, they do say the Italian fans are probably the most passionate in the world, obviously after the English and after the Germans. But, is that something you've experienced working with TM? Because it is a very small knit group of people, has a very family orientated feel about it. And with that, you get the passion because they're just dedicated to go racing like everybody is. But with the smaller teams, do you find that is more the case?
Yes, and for sure it's much easier to work. The smaller the team, the less problems you have, and the easier it is to work with the people. Like now I know them for 1 year, they're great. They're all doing a great job. Mm. And every team always in the paddock says, we are family, we are the biggest family. But I've been in many teams, and TM is actually, that's the real family, because it's small, everybody, it's a good cooperation, it's everybody do their best. And also beside the racing, they try to keep you happy. And that's really important.
Okay, we're almost out of time. Just a couple of quick questions.
Just quickly, talking of fans, fans from all over the world will be making a trip to the USA for the Motocross of Nations next weekend. I know you're not 100%. I know you've actually... Are you looking forward to it? Because you've competed for Team Germany before and won as well, haven't you?
Yeah, sure, I'm looking forward. Yeah. Especially going to US is always nice, something special. I watched the national race at Red Butte at YouTube, and the track looks really cool. I never been there, but it looks really nice on TV. So I'm really looking forward to go there, and I hope we can make something great for Team Germany.
All right. Well, look, Max, we are out of time, and obviously the season is almost done as well. Just two more races. Enjoy this weekend, and enjoy America. I know you're going to be taking your family there as well.
Yes.
Especially the little one.
Yes.
But Max Nagel, everybody, and we wish him all the best this weekend and for the future as well. But our second guest is in position, Jeffrey Herlings. We'll talk to him in just a moment. But let's catch up with the action from Assen. Here's some highlights from MX2 Race 2 from Assen.
Henry Jacoby was late arriving to the gate. He arrived just before the gate dropped, in fact. Completely messing up his strategy. From over on the right-hand side, though, Thomas Covington, just like he did in race one, sighed across everybody, but it was Prado once again. Foxhole shot number 25. He was hoping to turn it into 25 points as well in MX2 race two. Behind him, Thomas Olsen, Thomas Covington and Calvin Villanren for Team HRC on the number 10 Honda. Jonas just behind in fifth place. A little bit of rubbing between the American and the Dutch rider, but in the end, Villanren got himself into third, right in front of the home fans. Covington now in fourth place. Jonas in fifth, Ben Watson in sixth, lurking dangerously in the background as Villanren went after more. Thomas Kjær Olsen was that man in his sights. He stalked his prey, and eventually he got his opportunity around about the halfway mark. Better drive through the wave section. And in the blink of an eye, Villanren was now in second. Fantastic atmosphere all around this racetrack. Ben Watson found his way past Jonas early on in the race. Jonas, though, retaliated. He got second wind, found his way back into fifth place, but for how much longer? A simple slip from Olsen allowed his teammate through into third, a crucial point in the race as well, because that saw the American on the podium at the expense of Vlaanderen. Paul Jonas and Ben Watson continued to fight over fifth. And it was Watson who had the last word. He forced the defending champ into the outside, took over fifth place. Jonas now in sixth, but it was Prado who was in control here from the very first lap of race two. The Red Bull KTM rider eased his way over the line. His 15th race win of the season, his 14th career victory, his 11th of the season. Thomas Covington and Thomas Kjær Olsen joined him on the podium second and third, and the gap now between Prado and Jonas with a round to go is 46 points. The battle for third is almost done. Olsen now just needs 2 points more than Watson at the final round in Italy to be third for the second year running. But what a fantastic day here in Assen, especially for that guy. He now has one hand on that MX2 trophy.
Our second guest has arrived. The world champion is in the house. But before we talk to Jeffrey Herlings, let's take a look at how he won the title 2 weeks ago at home in Assen. Supposed to be some commentary audio on there as well, just to kind of give you that feel. But Jeffrey Herlings, 2 weeks ago, crown world champion at home in front of your home fans. I guess knowing you, how we know you, paying attention to detail, how many times have you watched that? Is that the first time you've seen it back?
Actually, to be honest, it's the first time I've seen it back.
Yeah.
The last few days and weeks been chaos. We've been so busy and going from left to right. But if I look better back at this, it's just wonderful, you know, to do it at home. You see all the fans, you know, like when I pass the tribune and then have all the team and family and everybody around. It's amazing.
And obviously watching that back then, bringing back some memories, how does it feel now, 2 weeks on?
I mean, you know, it's, you know, things pass by quick, you know. As we're 2 weeks further, now we're at the next race, we have to perform again, and next weekend again. But it was a great 2 weeks. I know I could really celebrate it, especially the first few days with my friends and family and, you know, with my fans. So it was a wonderful time. And but yeah, you know, like the day after, we're back riding again. So we didn't have so much time to have off.
No.
It's your fourth title, your first in MXGP, and like we just saw, winning at home, it doesn't get much better than that, does it? And it was pretty much the perfect weekend for you, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. You know, we won qualifying, we won both motos, and pretty dominant way and style, and then to do it in front of my home fans at home, yeah, plus winning the GP and the championship, you know, it couldn't be any better. It was like a perfect birthday gift, because it was my birthday a few days before, so I was like, that's a perfect birthday.
Yeah.
I want the same next year.
Yeah, where's the final round next year? And then
let's replace it to a Dutch round.
Yeah. Actually, it'll be the Motocross of Nations, probably not
far. Not far from there. So yeah, it'll be maybe a late birthday present if he could ever win with our country.
Well, I'll tell you what, we'll catch up with Jeffrey in a moment, but let's just tell you a little bit about our offer that we've still got running on MXGP TV. Just another quick reminder that if you don't have MXGP TV yet, or you know someone that needs it, we're still running our 70% discount offer. All the action is live and on demand, of course, from the first round in Argentina to the final round here in Italy at Imola. So why not sit back and enjoy the FIM Monster Energy Motocross of Nations next weekend as well from Redbud. We'll show all the live team presentations on Friday, the live studio show on Saturday with Jeff Emig and myself, and we have some fantastic guests lined up as well. You won't want to miss that. For more information, go to mxgptv.com.
Okay, thanks, Paul. Back to Jeffrey. Jeffrey, after that final round in Assen, I actually heard you gained some weight, a few kilos. Is that right?
So obviously, you know, when I look at food, for example, I already gained kilos. So I said, like, okay, if I win the championship from Sunday evening till Tuesday morning, I'm gonna eat like a pig and eat like whatever I want. So I stand on the weight scale on the Sunday morning, and then the next thing was on the Monday evening. So I ate it myself full Sunday evening, all the Monday. I gained 5 kilos. I swear to God, I even showed to Paul, and I was like, no way.
In a day?
And how big was the fries?
They were big, but seriously, I showed you 5 kilos.
How is that even possible? How do you do that?
Yeah, I don't know myself, but you know I lost them again. I lost them.
So you know what? I spoke to Dirk Gruvel on Monday night, actually, before the test, and he said, oh, you know, he's hard, so hard on himself. He's sacrificed everything, all the bad stuff, all the sweet stuff, everything else. He said he just sat there, had this big bowl of fries. He sat in the corner, he ate these things all to himself, and he said, you could see the enjoyment on his face.
I was so excited. And then the day after, we went to all-you-can-eat ribs, like the barbecue ribs full of the sauce, and yeah, that was a heavy one for me, but hey, we lost the 5 kilos again because we were ready to battle here in Italy and also in
already banging out motos on Tuesday.
Yeah, I had to, you know, I couldn't eat, I had to burn the calories.
Like you said, you're back to racing. How is your focus coming into this final round in Italy now that you have wrapped up the title?
It's a different approach, you know, the pressure is off, but you got a lot of other things to do now. You know, after you just won the championship, there's a lot of more media things going on, let's say, but you know, I'm still here trying to go out and win. You know, obviously the championship is in, but still, you know, I want to go out for a win, and obviously there's not much on the line. The championship is there, it's in, but you know,
number 84
would have been nice to spend all winter at a nice number 84 as a GP amount of wins.
Next week is Motocross Nations in the USA. You haven't done many, but the ones you have, you've always done pretty well. Second the last couple of years with Team Netherlands. What are your chances of going one better next week?
First of all, I never went 1-1, so that's my ultimate goal, to go 1-1 at the Motocross of Nations. And definitely with the team, we've been runner-up 2 years in a row, especially Majora. We've been leading actually until the last lap, I thought. But then France passed us last year again. We got second behind France. But now I think the main competition is Team USA. But it would be nice to put it on the box. And then next year it's on our home turf in Assen. So it would be nice if we could get on the box this year and fight for the win next year. But maybe with some luck, we can even do it this year.
Never know. You could even go to Assen with 1, 2, 3 if it all goes well.
That would have been nice.
Yeah.
That would be brilliant. Right, we've got some questions on social media for you, Jeffrey. The first one's from MJMX Practice. And he says, what motivates you the most besides winning?
Chips, fries.
Ribs, all you can eat ribs.
All you can eat ribs. Nah, it's like a lot of passion, you know. Like, it's hard to say because the real motivation is the winning. Yeah. So besides that, there's not much motivation going on because all the things you do and you work for is to put the result in the weekend. So also important for me is to enjoy it. But yeah, coming back, you know, winning is the ultimate motivation, you know.
Okay. And from Lewis800, what is the stupidest thing you did as a kid?
Oh, you got a few hours to sit here? Or,
we'll do a special recording
we'll
of that one.
Special recording. I think Paul remembered the one in Portugal, the interview
with
Mel Pocock. That was a really dumb one. Was a dumb one. Yeah.
Okay.
And last but not least, Ben Seberg, what is the weirdest thing that you do?
Do you have any kind of like weird, I don't know, superstitions or things you have to do? Do you sort of sit there, watch TV, go through like some weird kind of like...
Yeah, I do always before the moto. I'm so focused on the gate and, you know, thinking. And I'm always like doing a cross like 10 times over and over again. But I don't even realize myself. And then I look on TV and I'm like, do I really do that? So, yeah, but that's just because I'm not nervous at that time and I want to do good and I'm like so focused. And then I just like in that ritual kind of thing. So then I'm like, yeah, pretty awkward.
Actually, quite a few people have their own little rituals, don't they? You know, and but does that help you get settled then for?
Yeah, but like I don't even like, okay, when I do it, I know that I'm doing it. But at the same time, like, yeah, it's just because you're so focused and you're nervous and everything coming together. And then you just. Yeah, you just, I don't know, some people scream, some people make the same movement all the time, and I just make a few times the cross, like, hey, keep me safe, you know, like, Okay.
Well, look, Jeff, we are out of time. I know you're busy, and we are at the final round, but all the best for the final round.
Thank you,
hopefully,
Paul.
Number 84 is around the corner, and good luck at the Nations next week.
Thank you, Paul.
No worries. Right, we will talk to Michele Rinaldi in just a few moments, but let's catch up with highlights from MXGP Race 2 in Essen 2 weekends ago.
With the title sealed, Geoffrey Herlings went to the line with the number one plate on the front of his Red Bull KTM. But it was Glenn Coldenhoff with his second Fox hole shot of the year. He emerged through the first couple of corners ahead of his teammate Herlings. Halfway round the first lap, the unthinkable Herlings tipped over. A simple mistake for the new world champ in the sand as well. He was down in around eighth place and quickly went to work. Pushed past the 25 Monster Energy Kawasaki up to Sal, then went after Max Anstey. That move got him up into fourth place. He then went after Tim Geiser. Team HRC rider was on borrowed time. Meanwhile, at the head of the field, Tony Cairoli wasting no time finding his way into the lead. Both he and Koldenhoff constantly looking over their shoulders. They were like the rabbit in the headlights. They knew they were being stalked because the 84 was not that far behind. Lap 5, Herlings through on Koldenhoff to go into second. Geiser and Anstey fighting over fourth. Anstey made a decisive move there. Through the wave section, Geoffrey Herlings, very economical and very efficient, closed in on Tony Cairoli. He sensed an opportunity. The 9-time champ took him to the outside. He would have to do it all again. A poor decision from Cairoli late on in the race allowed Herlings to go through. He still could not relax, though, because Cairoli pushed him every step of the way. Koldenhoff and Anstey battling for third in the Grand Prix. Anstey was already there, but he wasn't sure. He kept pushing just to be secure in the knowledge that third place would be his. The fans came in their tens of thousands to salute one man. He made it a double victory here this weekend in front of his home fans. Win number 83 in the books, 16 now in the season, as he goes from strength to strength. No pressure with the gold plate at all. Anstey on the podium for the third time this year. The world championship done and dusted. Cairoli second. DeSalvo has 20 points over Tim Geiser as we head to Italy. But a fantastic occasion, a great advert for the FIA Motocross World Championship, and great sportsmanship from the 9-time and the 4-time world champions, both, of course, at Red Bull KTM. Thousands of fans. It was crazy. It was ecstatic. It was euphoric. His fans celebrated with him as if he'd just won the world title. He just had both. We go to Italy next time out. The yard of Tony Cairoli. Will he return the compliment there? Will he spoil the party and pick up the final win of the season? Well, we only have 2 weeks before we find out. But it was a great day, a great advert here for MXGP in Essen.
Hey everybody, welcome back to our live studio show here on MXGPTV.com. Our third and final guest is with us, Michele Rinaldi, Italy's first ever world champion. Of course, he's team owner for Monster Energy Yamaha, MXGP official. Welcome, and welcome to our studio show here, not so far away from where the base is. I know you've been around a number of years now as a rider and as a team manager, team owner. How many years actually now have you been involved in team management, and how many with Yamaha? It's been a few now, right?
Yeah, but you start to count because I started on the 84.
Okay.
For myself.
Yeah.
When I ran my team, I was rider and manager at the same time. And then at the time I had the mechanic for me. So we were only two people running our team.
Yeah.
And then I'm with Yamaha since 92, so it was already 27 years with Yamaha in a row.
Wow. That's
long.
That is some
that's
kind
long.
Of...
That's long.
Yeah,
that's
really. Long. And has this been one of the most difficult years for you as a team manager with rider injuries? Or, you know, because obviously Jeremy's experienced some, Roman again. But also, or would you say maybe 2007 with Josh?
I had even worse,
yeah.
Unfortunately.
Okay.
Even if this year things are not going well, I mean, at the end of the season because of the injuries.
Yeah.
But when you mentioned that 2007, we won 6 world championship in a row with Stefan Evans. Mm. And then I remember we were leading the championship with Josh Coppins by more than 100 points.
Yeah.
And then he got injured, 4th race to go.
Yeah.
And then we didn't win. We didn't even finish the top 3, I think. We finished 4th
yeah.
in the championship. It was very pity, but especially for Josh, because yeah. he really deserved, we
yeah,
think.
Yeah, yeah,
we
yeah.
des- yes.
Yeah.
That's racing.
It is.
It is racing.
It
and
is.
It's a shame because this season it did start so well for you as well as in Argentina. 2 riders finished in the top 5. At that point, in the first round of the season, did you think this is going to be a good year for us?
Okay. We thought even before the season started that
yeah.
it's going to be a good season, but you never know. And then, of course, injuries or problems are part of the competition. And, of course, it's not too bad and easy to be a good winner the time you can win and difficult to be a good loser. But with Romain, I think he is coming from some injuries, so he was slowly going to be very fast. So the last injury in Turkey, mm-hmm. I think he was doing already very good and very fast. You know, it was, I think, back to his position. The problem with Jeremy, we started very well at the beginning of the season because he really was riding well. Mm. And then he got injuries and a bit of a few times sick. So then his championship became very complicated.
Sure.
That's also not easy, but it's part of racing.
Mm. Well, let's talk a little bit more about Roman. It's been a tough couple of years for Roman, hasn't it? But this year he has been challenging for a top 3 position. Switzerland was perhaps his best performance. And then, like you mentioned, Turkey happened. The whole team, and that finishes his season, doesn't it, Turkey? And the whole team feels that pain, doesn't it? It's not just the rider that is affected.
Yeah, of course. Because the family is small, and the family just means a rider, and then team staff, and even above the team, mm. so in this case, the manufacturer. And then it's affecting everybody. So not only to the rider, also to the team, and maybe team is more used to that because we are in place since many, many, many mm. years. Anyway, quite many years. And the rider is also, his career is shorter on top level. So it's like a hammer, you know, for the rider to get injured and to not continue to race and participate until the end of the championship. But that's the way it is. As I said before, Roman was coming from another injuries. He was slowly going back to his best speed. And then not easy to beat Tony and then mm-hmm. Jeffrey. That's, of course, is a reality. But he was really performing well.
And obviously here, he made the podium as well, 2nd overall. As we said, his best performance. And it's when Roman is in this kind of mood, he's a fantastic rider to watch. So smooth, so flowing, so relaxed. And as you said, in Turkey, he looked... I mean, we were there. I don't think you were in Turkey. But he was looking fast right from the very first practice. And then... You know, yep. season is just finished, and that's it.
You're right.
Yeah.
So since the first free practice and then the time practice, he was the fastest.
Yeah.
It's, I think, also a consequence of his good speed from Switzerland and then the training and the race before.
Yeah.
And then, okay, sometimes you crash because you made the mistakes or you cannot control your emotion, you know, to go faster and faster. Mm. But this is, I think, is also part of the learning experience of a rider
yeah.
that before to be a champion is not that simple. It's not enough to go fast.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
You need to handle and control also your emotion at the right time. He's still young on this side.
Yeah, yeah. Mm. And then what about Jeremy? Obviously, the best we saw of him this year, he's had some fantastic rides, but the qualifying race went in Valkenswaard, round 2, again, you know, showing early on after Argentina, where him and Roman finished in the top 5, as we said, in the first round. He comes to Valkenswaard, wins the qualifying race. He says he's in the best shape of his career. He's strong, he's fit physically, mentally. And then in the first race or the second race, crash again, sets him back. I mean, it's just, especially for someone like Jeremy, you know, because he needs to have that confidence, doesn't he, to keep going.
I can only confirm what you said. In reality, when a rider, because you've been rider too, so when you do everything on training and you go fast and you think you are really ready for the competition, and then you do good and suddenly you crash and then you have to stay long time waiting for the to be back. It's really frustrating. So then in the case of Jeremy, he started well in the season. He was doing really, really good. And then suddenly when he crashed on the second moto in Valkersfall, he had to wait. We couldn't go testing and then he couldn't be ready for the next race. So then it's a problem and trouble starting that you don't know the end. And then depends also the rider, how does he feel and how does he can handle this problem. Also at the age of Jeremy, he was doing super good. He knew that was a very important season for him. And then when you have that, it's even worse than for a young rider going to his career starting from zero because you have maybe 10 years ahead of you. So you have to go in the mind of the man and the rider, the athlete, to think about how does it affect for him. Unfortunately, maybe another crash on the bad time.
We are almost out of time. Room for one more question.
Yeah, just one question for you. After Italy, Jeremy will represent Team Belgium with fellow Yamaha rider Jarno Hirt and Clément de Sal. Do you think Belgium are considered as potential winners in the USA next weekend?
Because you're going to be there as well as representation with him?
Yeah, but I have to be very neutral. Because we are talking about the nation. So then Belgium is not winning since quite long. I think some teams became weaker compared to before, like France is normally weaker than expected. So then some team is stronger than maybe expected. So I think Belgium can still always have a chance for the good result. But, you know, for the Belgian rider and the, for the people living in the tough condition, also you have to consider the mad condition in case of mad. That everything changed. So American could go much slower compared to the European. I saw in the past, it happened already, with European beating in the American easier than because of the track condition. We have to see, but they could be in the race. They could be in the race.
Okay, well, look, Michele Rinaldi, we are out of time. Thank you for joining us
here. Thank you very much.
All the best for this weekend, Home GP, the Nations next week with your riders, and of course for next year as well. Right, we are out of time, but of course on MXGPTV.com this weekend you can see all the action live as always. Starting today, women's race one at 1:25. We've got Yamaha Wiser 125 Blue Crew Cup at 3:35. We've got MX2 qualifying, MXGP qualifying, the usual times 4:25 and 5:10. And the final race today, EMX 300. Enjoy the final races of the year this weekend from Imola. We'll see you at the Motocross of Nations in 1 week's time. Thanks for watching this year. See you later. Bye for now.